year's work. Today we are going to discuss the Indo-US joint strategic vision for the Asia-Pacific and the Indian Ocean region and its implications for India's relationship with China. Prime Minister Narendra Modi is expected to pay an official visit to China before May this year. External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj has already paid a visit to Beijing to prepare the ground for the Prime Minister's visit. The questions we are asking today are, what does the shared vision of the US and India mean for the emerging geopolitics of the Asia-Pacific region? What are the common interests that India and the US share in this region? Will standing together with the US alienate China, and would there be any costs in trying to curtail or contain China's influence in the region with US help? And lastly, can the US be of any specific help to India in resolving its outstanding issues with China? To answer these questions and more, we have with us a very distinguished panel of experts. We have with us Ambassador Kawal Sibal, a formidable diplomat. He's been India's foreign secretary and ambassador to Russia, France, Turkey and Egypt. We have Ambassador Nalin Suri, one of our foremost experts on China. He's been India's ambassador in Beijing and has served in Indian missions in Hong Kong, Brussels, Dar es Salaam, Thimphu, New York, and as ambassador in Warsaw. And we have Ambassador Rajiv Sikri, another distinguished diplomat. He retired as secretary in the Ministry of External Affairs, was India's ambassador to Kazakhstan. He has served in Indian missions in Paris, New York, Moscow, and Kathmandu. He has overseen India's relations with East Asia, ASEAN, the Pacific region, the Arab world, Israel, Iran, and Central Asia. I welcome all of you to this discussion. Ambassador Sibal, let me begin with you. What is the geopolitical significance of the US-India joint strategic vision for Asia-Pacific and the Indian Ocean?
Well, I was a bit surprised that this was issued as a separate statement. Already when Prime Minister went to Washington in September, if you read the paragraphs in the joint statement, it was quite clear that we are now much more open in terms of flagging our common interests with the United States in dealing with the whole strategic picture in Western Pacific and in the Indian Ocean. In fact, Prime Minister, in his joint press conference there, made a remarkable statement, geopolitically is pregnant with a lot of meaning, that US is intrinsic to our Act East and Link West policies, which if you interpret it literally would suggest that US is central to our foreign policy now. And then in the joint statement issued after Obama's visit, again there is a robust para on the situation in the Indian Ocean and Asia Pacific. But then to issue a separate statement, you are actually drawing the attention of the international community and your own public that this is something you should focus on. Yep. And that we are reinforcing our ties with the United States on the basis of common interests in this area. To my mind, it is questionable whether giving this kind of a prominence better understanding with the United States, as also other regional powers, because if you read the statement, it spells out that was necessary or not. That's a matter of debate.
Okay. I'll come back to you on this issue of a separate statement, but let me go to Ambassador Nalin Suri. Ambassador Suri, is it in India's interest to work closely with US, Japan and Australia in the Asia-Pacific region to counter China's assertiveness, and also to work with the US to check China in the Indian Ocean region?
Well, I don't know what you mean by China's assertiveness vis-a-vis India in the Asia-Pacific region.
No, assertiveness not vis-a-vis India, assertiveness in the South China Sea.
I had reason to say that. See, it is in India's interest to work with all the major countries in the Asia-Pacific region, including China. Now, it's true that we have a separate vision statement on the Indian Ocean and the Asia-Pacific with the United States. I think the significant thing, it's not just the Asia-Pacific, it's the Indian Ocean and the Asia-Pacific. So basically you're now saying that India's extended hinterland is the east coast of Africa, the eastern seaboard of Africa and the western seaboard of the Pacific. And I think that is significant and it's important. But please bear in mind that when President Xi Jinping was here, in the joint statement issued by the President and the Prime Minister, there is a very long paragraph on cooperation in the Asia-Pacific region. And bear in mind what Foreign Minister Wang Yi has said in Beijing yesterday, that we are quite happy with India-US relations developing, because China-US relations themselves are very strong. I think we should not forget that the China-US relationship is several times larger and more important than the India-US relationship.
We're going to discuss that. I was merely asking you, is it in India's interest to work so closely and openly with the US in what is perceived as containing China's assertiveness.
Our position has always been, and I think remains, and what is happening in recent months is not inconsistent with that, that we want an open, inclusive and transparent security architecture in the Indian Ocean and Asia Pacific.
Okay. Ambassador Sikri, what are India's strategic interests in the Asia Pacific region, especially in the South China Sea? Are they so crucial that India has to go on the front foot with US without consideration for Chinese sensitivities? Or do you think we are unnecessarily getting drawn into the tension in the South China Sea?
I think we should not bother too much about Chinese sensitivities, seeing that the Chinese don't bother about our sensitivities. They go ahead with whatever they want to do without bothering whether India thinks about it. And Mr. Modi, in his statements during Xi Jinping's visit, said, well, you know, we have to be sensitive to our interests. And the Chinese have clearly not been sensitive. The second point is that in the Indo-US relationship, what was missing was a common strategic vision. You cannot build an edifice of relationship with the United States, in particularly in the defense field, unless you have some kind of a common vision. That was the weakness in the relationship earlier. Now that is there. Right or wrong is a different story. I think that, well, there are two points of view in India: that one, we should be sensitive to the Chinese interests. Two, that when we are closer to the Americans, the Chinese take us more seriously.
So my question also was, what are our strategic interests in the South China Sea? Well, why do we need to take a position on I think freedom of navigation, well, and open sky policies?
On the South China Sea, a lot of our trade passes through the South China Sea. And it is not just the South China Sea, it is the Indian Ocean, West Pacific region as a whole where we have vital interests. Yeah. This is a very important element of our policy, which is why it's now called the Act East policy. Yeah. And we feel that to protect our interests and to preserve peace and stability, the United States must be present here. That is a judgment call that we have made. Because without the United States, China, in our judgment it would seem, cannot be contained.
Fine. So you're saying it is attempted at containing China,
well,
with US aid?
Well, let me, contained is not right, balanced.
Okay, balance or rebalance or whatever you want to call it. But Ambassador Sybil, can cooperation with US in the Indian Ocean help India limit China's influence in the region? And what would such strategic cooperation in the Indian Ocean region mean on the ground?
In actual fact, we are cooperating with the United States more and more in the Indian Ocean area. In fact, even when we had reservations about being too open about relationship with the United States, when the previous defense minister, for example, was in position, and we were cheery about trilateral exercises or quadrilateral exercises, whatever. Our bilateral exercises with the United States, especially naval, were remarkable. They were very advanced exercises with aircraft carrier, nuclear submarines, everything there. And why were we doing this? Mm-hmm. In fact, in a sense, on the defense side, the naval side, we are in advance in terms of our political position on our relationship with the United States. And the freedom of navigation in the Indian Ocean and
security
other matters.
Security of sea lanes.
We were cooperating. Yeah. So we were already doing that. Now, point is, the United States wants us to actually join hands with them and be part of their so-called pivot, whatever they want to achieve in terms of the rebalance or pivot, and have India on their side. And they are pushing us by first developing this Indo-Pacific concept and now this Indian Ocean, linking Indian Ocean to Western Pacific, this and that, because their interests are there, and their interests are primarily in the South China Sea. In fact, in the joint vision statement, they don't talk about the East China Sea. They talk about the South China Sea, where they have very important strategic interests, and they want us to become party to that. Our interests really are in the Indian Ocean, and we have to then decide whether by extending our strategic horizon and becoming a subordinate player to the United States in the Western Pacific actually serves our interests, and how much it serves our interests remains to be seen. It's a matter of debate.
Okay. All right. We need to take a break at this point. We'll be back again with this interesting discussion in a bit. Stay with us.
यह है बेलाडीला माइंस का इलाका, छत्तीसगढ़ के दंतेवाड़ा इलाके में। सब जानते हैं कि यहाँ पर भारत के संविधान के विरोधियों का बोलबाला है।
सीआईएसएफ के जांबाज जवान नक्सलियों के आमने सामने, दंतेवाड़ा के बीहड़ जंगलों के बीचों बीच
कई बार उन लोगों ने हमले किए हैं, कभी कन्वेयर बेल्ट को जलाया, कभी डंपर्स को जलाया, कभी हमारे आदमियों के ऊपर भी हमले किए हैं। उन सब गलतियों से हम लोगों ने सबक लिया है।
और एक नया जंगी दस्ता CISF के निंजा वॉरियर्स, राष्ट्रीय सुरक्षा का नया एपिसोड CISF रेड जोन के अंदर, सिर्फ राज्यसभा टेलीविजन पर।
वेलकम बैक। वी आर डिस्कसिंग द इम्प्लीकेशंस ऑफ यूएस इंडिया जॉइंट विजन फॉर एशिया पैसिफिक एंड द इंडियन ओशन एंड इट्स इम्प्लीकेशंस फॉर इंडियाज रिलेशनशिप विद चाइना। Ambassador Suri, can we now say that India has joined the larger US effort to create a coalition of democracies, concerted democracies as they called it, in the Asia Pacific to balance China's rise, and that the quadrilateral strategic dialogue between India, US, Japan and Australia, which was proposed by Shinzo Abe, Prime Minister of Japan, in 2007, will now finally take off?
Well, I don't think I would agree with that line of argument at all. I mean, even if you look at the joint statement signed during the Obama visit, I mean, there is talk of possible upgrading of the trilateral dialogue with Japan. It has not happened. I think everybody is feeling their way. You have to accept the fact that China is now a big, powerful country.
Yep.
It has decided to throw off the shackles of Deng Xiaoping's injunction that keep your head down and, you know, do your work silently. It believes that its time has come. It sees a window of opportunity. It wants to seize this window of opportunity. It has made mistakes in that process already. It's put the backs up of several countries in the region. It is beginning to, I think, backtrack a little bit. But the fact that you have to deal with a growing and more powerful China is a reality which every country in the region will have to live with. Now, how you handle that is the question. And nobody is really talking about an antagonistic situation. Preferably, there should be, as I said in my earlier intervention, an open, transparent security architecture. It will take time to move in that direction. In the meantime, you know, we will all use each other to get further ahead. Okay. And you use the process of multipolarity in the region to try and make as many alliances possible to balance.
Okay. All right. Ambassador Sikri, what are the implications of this joint strategic vision of India and US for Asia Pacific and the Indian Ocean for India's China policy? Can the US help in India's reconciliation attempts with China, or do you think this kind of a shared vision statement will only muddy the waters of Sino-Indian relations?
I think that there are a couple of elements in this joint statement which can be interpreted as a little supportive of our position on China. For example, when it says avoid the threat or use of force and pursue resolution of territorial disputes. I don't know. It's just a little hint there. Second is the shared values, democracy, and the reference to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which is something that would bother China a bit, considering what's happening in Tibet and Xinjiang. But I think that on a broader security aspect, there are two elements that I'd like to flag. One, that we have endorsed the East Asia Summit, where the United States and Russia, apart from the other Asian countries, are present, which is an implicit rejection of the Chinese attempt to have a security architecture which leaves out foreign players. The second is that we are looking at connectivity of South, Southeast and Central Asia, which is a counter to the maritime Silk Route and the Silk Road economic belt.
Yeah.
So in that sense, you know, these are competing visions.
Yeah.
Because those visions are not something that I am comfortable with.
Yeah. We're going to discuss that in a minute.
One point I'd like to make, this is relevant to make this point, in terms of expectations from the joint vision and everything else. Look at the Indian Ocean area where we've been focused with the Americans. What has been actually the facts on the ground? China has developed this so-called string of pearls strategy, and now a silk maritime route or whatever they call it. Their submarines have been docking in Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka has made this outreach to China, which makes things awkward for us. Look at Gwadar and everything else. Chinese ambitions in the Indian Ocean have not been curtailed. despite our strong signals that we and the United States are working together in securing the sea lanes and everything else. We ourselves are talking about cooperating with China in terms of maritime security and everything else. So therefore, I can't see what great purpose is going to be served and which interests are going to be secured if we extend our collaboration with the United States to the South China Sea. If the American presence and our solidarity with them in the Indian Ocean hasn't helped us very much in terms of meeting the Chinese maritime challenge, I can't see how we're going to make too much of a difference to what happens in the Western Pacific.
Mr. Sudeep, going back to how it helps India vis-a-vis China, the joint vision statement, is India sending a signal to China, as some strategic experts have claimed, that look, Beijing should not expect any concessions from India, as Mr. Rajiv Sikri also said, so long as China continues to arm Pakistan, so long as China does not cooperate in tackling Pakistani terrorism, and so long as China goes on investing in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, softening to that extent India's claim over the region?
Look, Pakistan's usefulness to China is not simply because of the India factor. Pakistan remains useful for China for a variety of other reasons, including its soft underbelly in Xinjiang, the problem of terrorism, the Gulf area, the connectivity they seek through Pakistan to the Indian to the Arabian Sea. So it's important, and the entire importance of Pakistan in the Gulf region, which we can't deny. The Chinese at the same time recognize the importance of India in the emerging Asia-Pacific Indian Ocean region. So you now have a situation where both India and Pakistan are considered strategically important by different partners for different reasons. Now the question is, what is your focus? Now, as far as we are concerned, China will not stop aiding and abetting Pakistan. I think we should take this as a given. At the same time, as Sino-Indian relations become stronger, and they should become stronger, there's no reason why they will not become stronger, I think that automatically the Sino-Pak axis will begin to weaken, if not sort of wither away over time, because ultimately Pakistan's usefulness to China is limited in many ways. So if you can find other, take the very basic question of oil. If China is confident that it can get all its oil and gas, for instance, from Russia and the Central Asian countries, its dependence on the Gulf becomes that much less important. Okay. If China can secure Xinjiang in a better way, its dependence on Pakistan becomes less important. So I think we are in a very complicated and complex situation where there are too many balls in the air for each country. So each country will now try to leverage whatever it can, and you are signaling each other. I mean, our relations with China are also signaled to the United States. It's not just one-way traffic. Why are we just looking at it from one direction? Okay. And after all, Mr. Modi is going to go to China in May before he completes one.
Yeah, can I take that question to Ambassador Sikri? Mr. Modi has visited China 5 times in various capacities, and his Make in India strategy hinges on large investment coming from abroad to create jobs in India. And when he was Chief Minister, China became the largest investor in the state of Gujarat. This time also, there is a $22 billion Chinese railway project in the offing. When President Xi Jinping came, he made an offer of another $20 billion to start 2 industrial parks where, lakhs of jobs will be created. Now, if Chinese investment is so crucial for us, for creating jobs, because that's the idea of Make in India, then is it politic to join an alliance that might rile the political leadership in China, even if they don't say so publicly?
No, I don't think it's an alliance that will do. We are now, as I see it, becoming a more independent player, a little more on par with China, Russia, and the United States. It's not that, after all these countries have relations with one another. They agree on some issues, disagree on other. So similarly with India, we will not agree with the United States on everything. We will not agree with the Chinese on everything. But there are areas where we can cooperate. And I think that the reason why Prime Minister Modi is planning a visit in May is to see what we can do with the Chinese, because they are important to us. There's one other point I want to make. That is, the Quad is not on, but that threat, the dagger is always hanging. And number two, a very important point which has not been discussed, I want to flag it, the US support for India's entry into APEC. That is important because there is going to be the Trans-Pacific Partnership on current indications. And if we should not be left out of such emerging regional economic blocks.
Well, the statement doesn't say India should become a member of
APEC. No, it says it will support
the efforts of India.
Yeah, which means the Chinese, I think, will also support it. this has been talked about for many years now, but if the United States actively supports, I think we will become
a member. All right. We need to take a break again at this point. Stay with us. Don't go away.
In the Maths Factor, we travel through time and space and see how maths has evolved and how it is a part of the world around us. Join us on Rajya Sabha Television. Watch the Maths Factor every Sunday at 8 a.m.
Welcome back. We are discussing the implications of India and the US joining hands in the Asia-Pacific and the Indian Ocean for India's relationship with China. Ambassador Suri, you wanted to say something before we went on the break.
Yeah, to your last question, I think, which you addressed to Rajiv, I'd like to make the point that we should not overstate the importance of China for India's economic development. And I know we can have a separate discussion on that. But I think it is something we should bear in mind. I mean, the Chinese can play a useful role, but it will not be a critical role, it will not be that important a role. I mean, 20 billion investment over 5 years is no big deal, if it comes.
But they said 100 billion and
well,
brought it 100 down
became
to 20,
and now the language says endeavor to invest 20 billion. And I can tell you it's not going to be easy. Okay. Chinese are not easy investors. They're very good project doers. Okay. But investment is very different from undertaking projects.
Okay. Ambassador Sibal, the relationship between US and China, which Ambassador Suri earlier alluded to, is not only adversarial, it's a relationship of deep interdependency. China is the biggest buyer of US debt. US-China trade is massive. China accepts the dollar as international currency. Chinese market is a source of growth for the entire world economy. Under these circumstances, how much sense does it make India to become a variable, a function of this complex relationship between India and the, between US and China?
See, there are two things. One, as was said earlier, and I totally endorse that view, that China has been totally insensitive to our sensitivities, and they've been doing exactly what they want strategically, and they've created huge strategic problems for us. So we owe nothing to China. And therefore, if there is a feeling that by flagging our greater intensive strategic cooperation with the United States as a signal to China, fine, we can do that, and I won't be particularly bothered what China thinks of it. There may be some who argue that this might strengthen our hands vis-a-vis China. But my problem is that the United States, has been saying that we want to know how India is strategically useful to the United States. So I want to pose the opposite question, that how important is US strategically for India's interests? Because our interests on terrorism, Pakistan, Islamic extremism, all these issues which are around us, I can't see United States having been very helpful or being in a position to be very helpful even now. But they want to push us in terms of strengthening their hands vis-a-vis China and making their whole pivot and rebalance more credible. Whereas, as a matter of fact, what you said is absolutely right. And what was said earlier, the relationship with China is far greater than our relationship with United States can ever be. So what ties them together in terms of financial, economic relationship, the range of dialogues they have, even the management of the security situation there is something in which we are absolutely out of league in terms of. So why do we want to take unnecessarily the role of one of the cogs in the wheel of American strategic policies, and given the fact the Americans are committing huge mistakes everywhere in the world?
On this pivot to Asia business, at a time when majority of the Asia-Pacific countries are stakeholders in a good relationship with China, and at a time when they're all suspicious that this pivot to Asia is not going to take place anytime soon, because the US is going to be not going to be able to extricate itself from the Middle East anytime soon, what sense does it make, how effective can a US-led alliance in the Asia-Pacific region be?
Look, the US pivot is already happening on the ground. I mean, they will commit 60% of their naval forces, I think, by a particular year. And that process has already begun. And the withdrawal from Afghanistan and Iraq will help in that process. So I think to argue that the pivot will not happen, I don't think is quite accurate. The pivot is an old policy. It's not a new policy. You can call it rebalancing and call it whatever. See, to my mind, the United States' principal interest are in the East Asia region. It's Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, which are really fundamentally vital to the United States. The ASEAN is important, South Asia is important, but as China increases its influence in this region, the United States will need to counter it. So, you know, in that sense, I think you're again in a situation of flux. You also have a situation where Russia is weak right now for a variety of reasons, and anything can happen today. I mean, you know, the point is, if you have an incident in the South China Sea or in the East China Sea, we don't know how it will happen. So I think right now you have a situation where the United States and China, for that matter, will actually have to play what I would call a calming role. And again, in this process, you know, you have to build alliances.
Okay.
And you have to decide whether you want that alliance and whether that alliance is useful to you as a signal or more than a signal. And please remember, once you give a signal, signals have upsides, they also have downsides. And your other side will look at the downsides and react to the downsides.
Mr. Sikri, you had earlier alluded to it, but does the joint vision statement on the Asia-Pacific and Indian Ocean really mean that India will now be less enthusiastic about participating in Chinese regional trade initiatives, the Land Silk Route and the Maritime Silk Route and the BCIM, the Bangladesh, China, India, Myanmar corridor?
I think on the Maritime Silk Route and the Silk Road Economic Belt, I see no reason for us to be very enthusiastic, because all this, you know, they talk about one road, one belt, but all these roads and belts lead to China only. It's meant to serve Chinese interests.
They pass through other countries also?
Well, that's all right, but you know, if you see what they're saying, the only element of this which passes through India is the BCIM, where, I mean, we have agreed to examine it, it's being done at the track 2 level and so forth. Now, maybe there is some scope there,
yeah,
but I would not hold my breath on that. It will have to be part of a larger strategy vis-a-vis China. And one other point, I think that while we have been talking about India and the United States getting closer strategically, you will see that during Prime Minister Modi's visit, there will be an attempt to see how to engage the Chinese strategically and resolve the border.
We are running out of time. Let me ask the last question to you, Ambassador Sybil. How might the joining hands with US in the Asia-Pacific region impact Prime Minister Modi's visit to China?
I think on the one hand, one can argue that he is strengthening his hands vis-a-vis China by signaling that we are developing a much closer strategic vision with the United States, and the Chinese will have to take cognizance of it. On the other hand, the kind of trust building that the Prime Minister wanted to do, the personal relationship with Xi Jinping and everything else, to what extent that trust building that he wanted to do will be affected.
They won't sit on a swing in Asia or in Beijing.
There might be some, I think, not that it bothers me, let the Chinese distrust us as much as they want. But I'm be curious to know what kind of a discourse he will resort to when he's in Beijing, after the kind of statements that we have made together with the United States, with China in mind. Now, what is he going to say in China which will be robust, which will show that we want to further our relationship with China, deepen it, and still that will be congruent with what we are trying to do with the United States.
Okay, we've really run out of time, so I thank all of you, Ambassador Sikri, Ambassador Nalin Suri, Ambassador Kamal Sybil, for participating in this discussion. I hope you'll come again after or during Prime Minister Modi's visit, and we'll see what he says in Beijing. That's all we have for you today. Thanks for watching. Goodbye.